Good morning. It's good to see everyone in worship. Glad that you're here today. If you're a guest with us, we're especially glad that you're here this morning, and we invite you to share your information with us in the contact cards, the visitor cards that are there in the pews before you. Let us know how we can get in touch with you and share more about our congregation. Also, if you would seek prayer, there are prayer cards that are there in the pews, and we would invite you to fill those out and hand those to the ushers here in a moment during our greeting time or after the service, and we'll be sure to be in prayer with you in the days and weeks ahead. This time, let's look at a couple of announcements. One in particular, I guess this is the main thing I have on my mind, is the pumpkin patch. Are you surprised? I'm still thinking about the pumpkin patch. We've had a great start to the pumpkin patch. We've got a couple more weeks left in the month, and so Marissa Castor is the coordinator for this coming week. She'll be back at the back of the sanctuary after the service to kind of do some sign-ups for this coming week, and then I'll also send out the sign-up link in the email this afternoon with our online worship links. And so take a look at that. This is the time in the pumpkin patch kind of cycle where we sort of get fatigued and tired, and we've been pumpkin patching and we've been selling, but we still got to finish out a little bit. And so go ahead and take a look at that when it comes out. See when you can maybe sign up and help us out, and we'll finish out strong that way. Also, I just want to highlight, I did send out this week a link to an article from our annual conference newsletter about ministries of our church during COVID, and they just did a really nice job describing some of the things that we got to talking about. When we started visiting, it occurred to me just really how much our congregation had done in the midst of and in spite of COVID being a thing the last year and a half. And so if you want a really great opportunity to celebrate our church and what we've been up to and what God's been up to through us, go back and take a look at that, and I'll put it in the link this afternoon as well so you can take a look at that if you missed it this week. All right, at this time, let's stand and greet one another in the name of Christ.
Well, good morning. We can do better than that. It's a beautiful day. Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, there you go. Please turn to your call to worship, please. Oh God, we earnestly seek you. We thirst for you with our whole being. Because your love is better than life, our lips will glorify you. Please join with me in our opening prayer. Almighty God, we praise you for your goodness and faithfulness. We seek you in your holiness. We receive your grace in our inmost being. Grant us your Holy Spirit that we may be shaped by grace into the people you call us to become in Christ. We make this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our opening hymn is number 400 in your hymnal. Please join in singing, "Come, Thou Fount of Every Blessing."
Teach me.
may be seated. And as we turn to a time of prayer as a congregation, we want to remember in prayer the family of Sarah DeCamp, who passed away after a lengthy battle with colon cancer. She leaves behind her husband and three school-aged children. Sarah is a cousin. Okay, yes, a cousin of Byron DeCamp, and so we want to be in prayer for her family. And also, Janie Hensey had surgery this past week. We wanted to express thanks for your prayer. She's home and doing well. And also, Quinn Wood had surgery this week, and he is home. He got home yesterday also, and so we want to pray for him and his recovery time as well as Janie. You have prayers, you have concerns, you have celebrations that you came into the sanctuary with this morning, and so let's take a few moments of silence to take time and to make those prayers to God and then join our hearts and minds together. Let us pray. Almighty God, we praise you. We praise your holy name. We praise you from our inmost being. For we remember the benefits of knowing you. You forgive us our sins. You heal us. You redeem us. You crown us with love and compassion. You satisfy our desires with good things, and you renew us. Lord, we praise you and we give you thanks this morning. Lord, we pray for those whom we've named before you, for the family of Sarah DeCamp, that you would comfort them in their grief and strengthen them for the days ahead. For Janie Hensey, we give you thanks, and for Quinn Wood as well, for surgeries that were successful this week, and we pray for your continued healing in their time of recovery. Lord, we thank you for the cool weather that comes in and kind of refreshes and renews our strength. May your Holy Spirit be like that for our soul, to refresh and renew us, to give us new energy to follow you, to strive for you, to serve you. Open our eyes and hearts for opportunities that come to us each day to carry the presence of Christ into the situations in which we find ourselves, in friendships, in conflicts, in celebrations, all the places that we may have an opportunity to influence. May we bring the presence of Christ. These things we ask in his holy name. And we pray together as he taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Please stand and join in singing the first three verses of Amazing Grace.
I once was lost, but now I
may be seated. At this time, we pause to celebrate and give God thanks for our opportunity to give our offering. Our offering is made either online from our church website or from the link provided in our church emails, or also at the offering box at the back on your way in or out. And so let's pause and give God thanks for his provision in our lives and for the opportunity to participate in his kingdom work. Let us pray. God, we are indeed grateful that you have blessed us and that you continue to do so. You have provided for us. And Lord, we're thankful for the opportunity to give. So bless these tithes and offerings that we bring. May they be used to build up your kingdom and your ministry through the work of our church. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
please remain standing and join with me for our affirmation of faith. Church, what do we believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he arose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
All right, well, good morning.
Okay, before I get started, Miss Cindy started something a couple of weeks ago, so I got some bragging to do, okay? First of all, she talked about the junior high cross country a couple of weeks ago and Logan having stitches. Y'all remember that? Well, he got his stitches out, and do you know that they ran at district this past Saturday, and their team not only got first place, but they beat the pants off of Barber's Hill. Yeah. Sorry. And I have to go a little bit step further. We do have some kids that are in Liberty and also in Dayton, and both Liberty Band and Dayton Band got ones, so kudos. Kudos to those kiddos, too, yeah. So notice Miss Jessica started out with something kind of nice, right? You know, my mama always said, if you can't say something nice, don't say it at all. Well, today we're going to do something called the toothpaste challenge. Have y'all ever toothpaste challenge, yeah. So I have a little thing of toothpaste here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to unscrew the top. Now, don't do this at home, okay? That's my disclaimer. Promise me, do not do this at home, right? Okay, so I'm going to take this tube, and I have, so you people in the back, don't think I'm just putting it on the altar. I have a paper plate, and I'm going to squeeze all of that toothpaste out, every bit of it. Oh, my gosh, every bit of it. Now, how many of y'all think that now I can put all that toothpaste back in this tube? Probably not. You know, you are so right. It's kind of silly of Miss Jessica to even think that I could put it all back in after I squeezed it all out. So let me just tell you this. You know, that toothpaste challenge kind of reminds me of words in our mouth. Have y'all ever said something that you go, oh, whoops, did I say that? I wished I hadn't said that. I want to take it back. Can you take it back? No. You know, sometimes maybe you might be on the playground and you might get, oh, I don't know, in an argument or something, and you might say something ugly. Can you take those words back? No. You can say nice words, and those are okay to stay out there, right? Well, what about this? Have you thought about this? What if you were on a softball, a soccer team, or a baseball team, and you're playing against your friends, and in the heat of the game, you might have said some kind of ugly words or something. Yeah, that's not nice. Can you take those words back? No, of course not. Of course not. And you know what? Now, I'm going to talk to some of my big friends here, okay? Because this is not just for little kids, but for big kids, too. You know, when we get in situations, sometimes we need to watch what we say. We need to watch what we do. We need to watch what we put on social media. Just saying. So, one more situation. Have y'all ever had a new kid come to school and everybody makes fun of that new kid? Yeah, that's not nice, is it? Can you take all those mean words back? No, you can never put words back in your mouth any more than we could put the toothpaste back in the tube. So I want you to remember, but do you remember the children's rhyme, sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me? You know, that's wrong. Words do hurt. Yeah, that's not true. And so I want you to remember, God says that we need to always lift people up. We need to always say nice things and love people and love one another. In the Bible, it also says, he who holds his tongue is wise. So next time you start to say something angry or ugly or mean, I want you to remember the toothpaste challenge. Will you do that? Okay. Let's bow our heads and pray. Repeat after me, please. Dear Father, help us to let every word we speak be pleasing in your sight. Let no words come from our mouths that would be hurtful to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay.
Amen, amen. Good word, good word. As we turn to our scripture reading today, we're continuing to look at the life of David. We're in 2 Samuel chapter 9, and this is a story that you may or may not have heard before. It's a character, there's a character in this story that you may or may not have heard of before. I had never heard of him until a visiting preacher in seminary had a sermon titled Mephibosheth, God Bless You, because his name sounds like you're not sure what just happened, right? Have you ever, somebody coughed and you weren't sure if it was a sneeze or a cough, and you're like, God bless you, maybe, I think, I'm not sure. Anyway, it's about someone named Mephibosheth and David, and it brings up a really great story for us as we look at the life of David. Now, this one's titled Grace, and that does play a big part of it. But, of course, the last couple of weeks, we've really seen how grace has worked in David's life, where the grace of God in David's life led him to deeper devotion, and how God's grace led him to deeper humility. And now we're going to see an opportunity to see yet again how God's grace affects David. So in chapter 9, verses 1 through 13, hear the word of God for you this day. David asked, "Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Now there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. They summoned him to appear before David, and the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" "At your service," he replied. The king asked, "Is there no one still alive from the house of Saul to whom I can show God's kindness?" Ziba answered the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan. He is lame in both feet." "Where is he?" the king asked. Ziba answered, "He is at the house of Machir, son of Amiel, in Lodabar." So King David had him brought from Lodabar, from the house of Machir, son of Amiel. When Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David, he bowed down to pay him honor. David said, "Mephibosheth." "At your service," he replied. "Don't be afraid," David said to him, "for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table." Mephibosheth bowed down and said, "What is your servant that you should notice a dead dog like me?" Then the king summoned Ziba, Saul's steward, and said to him, "I have given your master's grandson everything that belonged to Saul and his family. You and your sons and your servants are to farm the land for him and bring in the crops, so that your master's grandson may be provided for. And Mephibosheth, grandson of your master, will always eat at my table." Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, "Your servant will do whatever my lord the king commands his servant to do." So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. Mephibosheth had a young son named Micah, and all the members of Ziba's household were servants of Mephibosheth. And Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem because he always ate at the king's table. He was lame in both feet. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Would you pray with me? O Lord, we give you thanks for your word made flesh in your Son, Jesus Christ, and for your word in the scriptures through which you reveal yourself to us. And we pray in these moments together that you would speak your word, that you would write your word upon our hearts, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. So how many times do you think I practiced saying Mephibosheth this week? Boy, man, that scripture reading was just lots of Mephibosheth. Sometimes when you read the Bible, do you ever wonder why we carried some names over and those are names we still name people and others we just left behind? You know, Saul, I mean, you hear that from time to time. But David and Jonathan, you know, you hear those a lot. Mephibosheth, you don't ever hear about people named Mephibosheth. I don't know. Anyway, okay, that wasn't part of the sermon. I just couldn't help myself. Years ago, and I say this from time to time because it's so interesting. Years ago, my father-in-law found an article where they said that it was more interesting to ask about a favorite meal than a favorite food. And the reason why is because a favorite meal can have more going on to it than just something that you liked. It was a moment. It was memorable. It may be one of the best things you've ever eaten, but chances are there was some other reason that it was memorable and that became a favorite for you. Now, I could pick a lot of different memorable meals, but I want to suggest to you that some of my parents' memorable meals are meals that they had with my wife and I at Panera Bread. Anybody ever eaten Panera Bread before? Boy, it is so good. You just order bread and have some bread with the bread. It's pretty amazing. We went to Panera Bread with my parents. We met them because they were near enough, living near enough to us that we wanted to meet with them and let them know that we were expecting our first child, their first grandchild. And so we had met them at a Panera Bread not far from their house because it was in driving distance for us. And we broke the news and we were all excited. It was a great time. Well, a few years later, we had a second announcement to make, and it was just so convenient, and it was nice and easy because you can go order at the front, and you can sit down and go pick up your food. It was very easy, and it was budget-friendly and all those sorts of things. So we ended up at the Panera Bread again and let them know that we were going to have another child, and they were very excited. And then a third time, we had an announcement to make, and that Panera Bread was just so convenient to their house. And it was such a good little, you could find some good comfort food there at the Panera Bread. So we met him again. And since that time, every time we've called up and said, well, where do you want to eat? Well, what about a Panera Bread? They've thought, is there any news coming? You know, is there something we should expect because we're going to Panera Bread? It was memorable. You know, they knew, they remembered what happened when you went to Panera Bread. Guy and Abby are having another baby. Now that's no longer true. That's never going to be true again. If we ever go to Panera Bread with you, we don't have anything to share with you about children, just to be said. But those were very memorable meals. My parents held on to it. It made an impression. I'm bringing that up because memorable meals happen in the Bible too, right? Of course, in the New Testament, you've got the meal that was with the disciples in the upper room where they knew it was the Passover meal, and that was such an important meal, but Jesus did something special that made it particularly memorable for them, and even gave them a command to remember it. And every time they gathered together to remember him because of it, it was a very memorable meal. In David's time, you know, David came and he came on the scene, really, we heard about him in the anointing, but then we didn't really see a whole lot until we see him come and defeat Goliath and be invited to eat at the king's table. How memorable do you think it was the first time that he ate at the king's table as this victorious young warrior? What an honor and what a privilege. There's another meal in David's story that he missed, but that Jonathan was attending. And we looked at that a few weeks ago when we looked at the power of friendship in the Christian life and what a friend that Jonathan was to David. And I think it was a memorable meal for a negative reason when Jonathan was there and David had suspected that Saul had it out for him and wanted to kill him because he might be considered a rival to the throne. And Jonathan said, that can't be, but I'm willing to check it out and confirm whether or not that's true. And it was at a meal where Jonathan kind of floated a question that was meant to test and see where his father's mind and heart really were, and as it turns out, they were against David after all. That was a tough meal for Jonathan, but it was a very memorable meal. And in the scripture lesson today, the story today, we have a very memorable meal occurrence. Because David starts out, he is just riding a tremendous high. I mean, the kingdom has kind of been consolidated politically because he's got his capital in Jerusalem, which is situated to unite the northern tribes with the southern tribes of Israel. So that was an important piece. And they've moved the Ark of the Covenant, which carried the Ten Commandments and the scrolls and those sorts of things. So the religious heart, the thing that symbolized and was for them a way to manifest the presence of God in their midst, they moved that to Jerusalem so that that's got the spiritual heart of the nation. And David has had this amazing experience of God giving him peace from all his enemies around him. David was a warrior and was fighting all the time, but he's got peace from all his enemies around him. And he desired to do something for God, to build him a house, a temple. But God said, no, a temple will be built, but not by you, because I want to hammer home the message of grace, that you've done nothing for me to establish my name, and that I have just given to you of free grace. And so I will establish a house that is a dynasty in your family for you. And David is blown away by this act of sheer grace and generosity and self-giving on the part of God. Amazing. And so David is enjoying this, and we come to this chapter, and he says, is there anyone left in the house of Saul to show kindness to for the sake of Jonathan? Now, Jonathan had died in battle. Jonathan died with Saul in the same battle in which Saul died. And so no one was left. There was a different son of Saul who tried to take over the kingship of Israel, but he died in the... at that time when he died, Jonathan had died, but there was a nursemaid for Mephibosheth, who was just a very young child. And when they were fleeing, because they were afraid of what might happen in those days, when the new king came into being, one of the things that you did first was you cleared house of any possible rivals. And so it was not uncommon at all for everyone else to be killed who might potentially have a claim to the throne. And they were afraid, so they ran. But as she was running, she dropped Mephibosheth as a child, and he was injured, and he was lame in both feet, and he could never walk. And so that's why you heard it said a couple of times, now he was lame in both feet, because they're trying to remember, as they're telling this story, as they're recording it, they want to remember that this is the person who is lame in both feet. They want to remember that detail. And so Mephibosheth is brought to David. And David says, hey, I want you to eat at the king's table. I'm going to restore the land of your grandfather Saul to you because you're still around. And Mephibosheth, who was kind of minding his P's and Q's and showing up and saying, at your service, anything you want, anything you need, right? Now, that was a good way to address the king, but Mephibosheth might have thought, you know, I'm the last one around from Saul's house. I'm the only rival remaining. And so that's why he says, who am I that you would show such kindness to a dead dog like me? Because instead of getting rid of every rival, David sees in Mephibosheth an opportunity to show the Lord's kindness. So here's the main thrust for us this morning of this particular story. This really unique, seldom noticed kind of story, but really wonderful, rich story, is that graced people grace people. Graced people grace people. If you have been graced and it has affected you, if it has settled into you, if it has impacted you, if you have received it deeply into yourself, if you have been graced, then the work in our hearts is to go forth and to grace somebody. David had just received grace upon grace. He had been graced by God. He had been led since he was a young child. He had had opportunities come his way through hard times. The Lord had preserved him and protected him and guided him. And then when God established him over Israel, David wanted to do something. And God said, nope, I'm going to show you more grace. I'm going to establish your whole house for you. And so David had nothing left to do but say, is there anybody left of Saul's house? The only other family with a claim to the throne of Israel, to whom I can show kindness for the sake of Jonathan. Because David had not only been graced politically and graced spiritually, he had been graced relationally with such a loyal, good friend, and he still remembered to that day how much it had meant to him. Graced people grace people. Now, sometimes do that because of bad experiences that we've gone through that we want to help other people through, right? Things that were negative as a part of our life that we sense an opportunity to turn it into something where we can give back or can give forward to people so that others can have a source of strength or a way to get through or a message of hope or a lift up or those sorts of things. How often do you hear a testimony of someone who says, I've been in that place, I don't ever want to go back, and I feel like I found an opportunity to help other people who've experienced what I do, and I can do it because I've been through it myself. There's so many examples. Chuck Colson was in the Nixon administration, and he went to prison for tampering with the election. And when he got out of prison, he had become a Christian, and he saw an opportunity to reach out to people who he now had a kinship with that he would have never had a kinship with before. And he said, Christ got me through that experience, and I want to share Christ with people who I have something in common with now. And so he created a prison fellowship, an incredible ministry, and he really pioneered the whole notion of Christians being deeply involved in prison ministry over the last 50 years or so. Christians have been involved in past times, but he kind of got that modern movement in America really going in some powerful ways. The hymn writer for Amazing Grace that we sang this morning, John Newton, was a captain of a slave trading ship, and he was convicted and realized he had been a part of something evil, despicable, filthy, and wrong. And he turned his life over to God, and he turned his life around, and he turned his life against what he had been doing before. And he penned a hymn saying, it's amazing grace that someone who participated in such cruelty, injustice, and evil could be saved and whose life could be transformed. If you've ever been through something, you've got an opportunity to grace somebody. Sometimes we take good things that have come into our lives and share them because we want other people to have that opportunity and experience before. Now, I didn't get a chance to warn them in advance, but one thing that was prominent in the article that came out in the newsletter was our MOPS ministry, Mothers of Preschoolers. Now, Marissa and Marissa and Emily had some background with that, and it had been a source of strength for them, and they said, you know, this was good in our life, and we want to share that good in somebody else's life too. And so they've started that ministry with us not even a year ago. And it's building and building, and we're delighted to get to support that. But that's an example of saying, hey, I had something good happen in my life, and I want to share that good with others too. David had that experience. He had the goodness and kindness of a friend in Jonathan, and he said, is there anybody that I can show kindness to for the sake of my friend Jonathan? I've had something good come into my life. I want to get on board with that. Where have you been inspired because something good happened in your life and you said, boy, that other people need that too? That's an opportunity for us to grace others, because graced people grace people. Now, when we look at the New Testament, we find over and over again that the people in Jesus' life who come near to him end up turning their lives and being transformed into people who grace others. Peter and the other disciples were graced. They turned from deserters to defenders of the faith. Powerful witnesses for Jesus, even though they had failed him at his greatest moment of need. But when he appeared to them, resurrected, breathing into them new life, they went forth and were powerful witnesses. The women who were devoted to Jesus were dejected and discouraged, but when they encountered the risen Jesus, they just increased their devotion and their inspiration and their commitment. Stephen, the very first Christian martyr, who's recorded in the book of Acts, around chapter 6, 7, 8, he's right in there. He doesn't get a whole lot of pages, but he's got an incredible influence, because Luke shows us that the influence of Jesus was so great in his life that just the same as Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing, to the people who crucified him, Stephen, as he was being stoned to death, to be put to death for proclaiming the name of Jesus, he looked up to heaven and he said, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. He had been a graced person. And in the most awful, difficult of moments, he was still gracing the others who were doing evil to him. In the New Testament letters, in Paul's letter to the Romans, he says this, it's God's kindness that leads us to repentance. I love that. I love that because that's something that you and I can do. We can, like David, say, is there anyone to whom I can show kindness for the sake of Jesus? Graced people grace people. David said, is there anyone who I can show kindness to? And he found Mephibosheth. And he brought him in and he said, I'm restoring everything of your families to you. And you will always eat at the king's table. And that meant protection and it meant provision. It was a potential rival who was brought into communion with the king. And Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, when he was celebrating the Passover meal with the disciples, around that table, and that table forever symbolizes Jesus welcoming those who either pit themselves against him as rivals or keep turning aside to rivals of Jesus as the king and the center of their life. When we had turned away from God and become rivals to him, Jesus came to give himself for us, to show God's kindness and to welcome us back. Is there anyone to whom I can show kindness for the sake of my friend Jonathan? David said. God showed us kindness in the giving of his son. It's his kindness that leads us to repentance. Graced people grace people. And so who are you called to grace this week? What would happen if we woke up each day and said, is there anyone to whom I can show kindness? And just looked for how the Lord might answer that prayer. Wow. What a church we can be. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this remarkable story of a graced person in David looking for a way to show kindness, showing grace to someone who would otherwise have been considered a rival to his throne. And Lord, we gather this morning to worship you, to love you in song and prayer and praise and giving in every single way, and to lay down ourselves before you, to come and surrender, and to find ourselves welcomed by the kindness of the King, Jesus. Help us to go forth and ask, is there anyone to whom I can show kindness? And see how you might answer that prayer. For we ask this in Christ's holy name. Amen. Let's stand together and sing our closing hymn. And as we do so, we would open the altar of the church. If you had come to profess your faith in Christ or renew your commitment to Him, we would welcome you at this time. If you had come to seek prayer, we would welcome you as well. Let's sing together.
Our hymn of commitment is number 338 in your hymnal. Please join in singing the first and last verses of Where He Leads Me.
Marissa is going to be at the back to help us sign up. She's got a page to help sign up for Pumpkin Patch times this week. If it'd be helpful to go ahead and do that with her, and then she can put you into the online sign up, please do that. Otherwise, please check and see where you can help out this week so that we can finish strong with Pumpkin Patch. Now receive this blessing and benediction as we go forth. Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of His Holy Spirit at work within you. Go in the peace, the power, and the presence of Christ to be His witnesses. Amen.